For now, we'll be dealing with data scraping using RPA. Before just getting into the topic, I just want to ask a few questions. As per my understanding, I think you all have been going through a series of RPA workshops recently. And that's something which is interesting here, because many of you here are already aware of its benefits and you already understand its importance in the industry. As per my understanding. Well, with that, what we will do is, let's have a quick game here. I will just take you through a few things before we just get into the topic. As you can see here, right, I just want you to go here and let's play a game here. I just want to know how many people of you are actually aware of robotic process automation. Okay, to just go into it, what we'll do is, you have to just go to this site here in your mobile or your laptop. Okay, just open www.menti.com and enter this code and just input yes or no, just to understand where you stand right now. Okay, let's spend 2 to 3 minutes here to get some responses from the participants. Guys, if you're not clear, you can just ping in the chat box so that we can look at it. It's easy. You have to just go to this website and then enter this code and then give out your feedback. Oh, great. We got one response. We'll wait for another 2 minutes. Okay, someone know what is RPA. You are free to give out your answers. So there is no one will be asking you about why you don't know RPA. Just a fun way of getting inputs from people to understand what they are actually in need of. We'll wait for another 1 minute. Great, we have received 4 responses. Yeah, guys, so with this, I can conclude that around the people that we have right now, 50% know what is RPA and 50% are not aware of what the RPA itself as a technology, right? With that, I would just like to give a line about RPA, just for your understanding. RPA is something we can define as a technology which will mimic the human actions. Okay, basically what we see right now in the industry are there are different processes available which can be automated. Okay, there doesn't need a human intelligence to get them done. For that, we can have RPA. Why RPA? So RPA, the things that are possible with RPA, we can do it with programming also. But when it comes to business persons, okay, they know what is a business. Okay, what are the different things that are being done in the business? So they don't know programming, right? So that's where RPA will be useful. Because they don't have to write tons of programming lines to get some work done. They just have to drag and draw a few things and the work will be done. Okay, the job they are expecting will be done. So that's where the RPA is finding its importance. Okay, because there is no much programming knowledge that goes into it. With that advantage, right, there are a lot of companies that are adopting RPA. Okay, if I just say, what are the different industries? Okay, again, let's go ahead and try to get some inputs from you. It's the same again, but this time the question is different. Which industries, according to you, are being benefited from RPA? Okay, here also, we'll just spend 3 minutes maybe, okay, to get some inputs. Here, there is no yes or no. You are free to enter whichever industry you feel are being benefited. Again, just go to this link and then enter this code and just type your responses. Just to give some hints, some industries that are being benefited by using RPA are banking and insurance. Great. Nice. So we have received one input right now. Thanks for whoever has given that. Survey data analysis bank. Okay. Any more responses that you have in your mind? We still have 2 minutes to go. Education. Great. Go on. Don't think much on that. Anything that comes to your mind, okay, whenever you might have gone through some industries, right? Whatever. You might have been to hospital, you might have been to some company, you have been applying to some jobs. Okay, great. Yeah, go ahead. Still, we have 1 minute to conclude something from this. Just please think about the real time practical examples. These are good. Yeah, guys. So as we have already got, right, there are a few examples that we have got. One is BPO, finance, insurance, bank, education. If you want me to add something to it, it can be healthcare, telecom, IT, and HR, okay, HR operations, and many such kind of things. So with that basic understanding of what is RPA and which industries are actually using it, we can move ahead. And before going forward, I would just like to tell that many people get confused about what is RPA and what is UiPath. Okay, RPA being a technology, because UiPath have a lot of hype around. Just to give some clarity over there, RPA being a technology, it is being facilitated by around 100 plus tools, okay, in the market. Few of them are UiPath, then Blue Prism, Automation Anywhere, RoboCorps, Power Automate, like that. If I just continue taking the names, right, there are 100 plus tools to facilitate that. For our understanding right now, for this particular session, we'll be taking UiPath. Okay. And with that, we'll just go forward with our topic, which is data scraping using RPA. Okay. So this is our topic for now. To just give an overview of what is data scraping. What do you mean by data scraping? In general, it can be defined as a technique, okay, where a computer program just extracts some data from any given source. It can be web application, or it can be some other different web applications available to us. And then we can store them as whatever field that we want. Okay, it can be CSV files, database, spreadsheets, and other things. Completely depends on the user experience or user preferences. So this is how, if you can see the screen, right, there are three steps that are involved into it. There's a site from where we are taking this web scraping technology, and then we get our extracted data. With that told, right, web scraping, which is also known as with different names, web data extraction or data scraping and many other things, actually provides a solution for those who actually want to get access to structured web data, okay, which can be further used for, basically most of the data that we extract will be used for analyzing and for monitoring, okay, based on which the businesses majorly can take some steps or some decisions. Okay, you can say, what is the need of this particular web scraping, when we can do it from the back end. Okay, what happens is when we do the web scraping, so we might end up taking a lot of time, okay, because we are doing it from the UI perspective. So for someone who is not aware of what is UI and what is front-end and back-end, front-end, every application, okay, whenever you come across any web application, it can be Amazon, it can be Facebook or Twitter, anything. Okay, there will be two things to it. One is front-end and the another one is back-end. Front-end is what you actually see, okay, these cool buttons which say submit, like, comment kind of things. And there is another thing called back-end, where you're actually your actions will be considered and where the actions will be manipulated. Okay, it's a kind of if you take human, right, the skin is what you see as a front end, and heart and everything, kidney and everything goes as a back end. Okay, so that is the main thing, just to say that that is the main thing that goes behind particular web application. Okay, in this case, okay, if you are thinking, why not go with backend? Okay, why should we open an application and then scrape the data? When that comes into mind, right, we can do that, because when we do with that particular thing in mind, it's called APIs. Okay, application which can actually achieve us that particular goal of scraping the data. But okay, this data scraping can be helpful if we are trying to get some data from public sites which actually doesn't have an API. Okay, or it does have, but it provides a limited access to that particular site. In that particular moment, we will use data scraping. And now, as we all know, what is data scraping? Maybe guys, you can just share your comments. So just to know if you people are comfortable with whatever I have told, you can just type out in chat. Chat is not available. If chat is available, you can just give out your outputs, your responses, that you were clear or something. So Kirtan ma'am, do we have any chat facility over here so that people can type? It was clear.
Yes, sir. It is available. For you, it is not enabled, right, sir?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe yes. I'm using web browser, right? So it's not available for me.
Oh, okay, sir. It is available. Chat window is available for the participants.
Okay, guys. So you can just go ahead and say it was clear so that I can just go forward. Yeah, with that, right, I will just move ahead with different ways of...
It's clear, sir. No problem.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, ma'am. Yeah, with that, right, let's look at different ways in which we can achieve this. As I have already told, okay, there are different ways of achieving it. So one way is manual process. And I say manual process, it is something that we actually used to do some years back, which is copy paste. Even now, okay, if maybe in some situations, whenever you go to some government offices, right, you will find people actually copying something from site and pasting it somewhere. Okay, it is called copy paste, control C, control V process, which will actually take up a lot of your time, and it actually doesn't worth your time. Okay, you should be working on something productive rather than just being doing some copy paste work. So that is manual process. And then the other way to do data scraping would be using extraction tools. In this case, if you're someone who is not well equipped with programming skills, okay, you're just a business person who want to get some work done, in this case, they can use tools like UiPath, and there are 100 plus tools available in the market which can get you that work done. Okay, and then coming to existing libraries and components. If you are a programmer, but you're less equipped at web scraping, okay, so this time what happens is, though you're a web programmer, you have to be building something from the scratch. Okay, and which doesn't seem to be good for you. In that case, what you can do is you can take advantage of existing libraries. Existing libraries, something like Nudge, Scrapy, and something of that kind. Okay, they are available for free, and you can just use those libraries and get your work done. In this case, consider, okay, you are a programmer, but you don't want to spend much time on data scraping. Then you can go ahead with this approach. And the last one, okay, the custom scripting. custom scripting, what I can say is this option will leave you with a lot of customization options. As you're a programmer and you also have a lot of time with you, and because with extraction tools, right, you have to be spending a lot of money on that. Okay, every month you will end up spending some subscription amount to them, so which will add on to some other extra cost to your business. But here, using custom scripts, you're free to use any language. You can use Python, you can use JavaScript, you can use Perl. Okay, whatever language you can use, and you can be in a position to customize to whatever extent that you want. Okay, these are a few options available. And with that, another final option that I would like to say, discuss is, if you feel all these four options as boring, okay, and if you just want to get it done while you are in vacation or somewhere, you can just try hiring a data scraping freelancer also. Okay, but it will cost you around $5 per hour, okay, as per the USD, American market. Okay, these were the options that we can have when we decide to have some data scraping process being going on. And as we have already discussed, and as per our topic, right, which is RPA, we'll be using some extraction tools, in that specifically UiPath. Okay. That told, I will just move on with a little example. Considering this is the use case that we have, okay, here we will have a user database and which will be scraping. I move on to this. As you can see, this is an application that we have developed internally for some demos that we have with the clients. Okay, so here it's a simple data, it's a simple website which have some data fields into it. Okay, there is ID name, division, and here we will have this particular ID of him, that particular person. Every person will have this. If I suddenly ask you to, maybe someone of you, okay, who doesn't know RPA or who is like, is not a good programmer, okay, or he just want to get the work done. In that case, you can try to, the task here is to fetch all this data available here. In this case, the number one approach that we thought was to copy paste it, like copy this and paste it into an Excel and then copy paste it kind of things. Another one would be writing lengthy codes. Okay, if you just go to Google and type data scraping programming code, okay, you will get some code which will actually span to around 200 lines also sometimes. Rather than that, what I can do is, we have UiPath tool, and which has got a community edition, okay, and it is free to use. Maybe if you are someone who is not familiar with UiPath, it's an RPA tool which is also capable of facilitating data scraping. Okay, just simple. There is a website that maybe if someone of you who is interested, they can reach out to me, and I will just give you a few steps to which you can get this installed on your system and you can start experimenting it. Okay, this is how the homepage of this will look like. If I just go to process, because I'm trying to create a new project and get my work done, right? So that's where I can just create data scraping, and then I will just create it. Okay, it's how simple it is to actually create a new project here in UiPath. So if your interests are with Python or other things also, it's a simple thing, okay? And then once it is done, as I have already told, okay, this data scraping tools comes with a lot of drag and drop functionality. Okay, here, just to start with this, and just to give a small introduction about UiPath, every time you create a new project, it will give out some default settings to you. Okay, it will give a default XAML file in which we will actually be, doing some, what you say, some flow design, okay? This is the file where we will do the flow design. And this is a JSON file that we will get, which will have some basic data into it. Okay, which file to run as a default file, and what is the name of the project, and what description would you like to give, and the dependencies. Okay, if we are using Excel, then we have to have Excel activities. Activities, when I say activities, activities are common small blocks, okay, which will help you achieve whatever job you're trying to do. And then by default, this four will be there in any project. Excel will give you Excel functionalities and mail functionalities, and system are something that are like, if you want to cut down a string, okay, in that case, you will do some manipulations and do something of that kind, right? Move files, copy files, and all these things will be available here. And the last one is UI automation. Here, one thing, UI automation will help you achieve something where you need to interact with some web application, which we are going to do right now. And these are a few other internal things that the UiPath will be using. And the other things, nothing you have to do about it. Then, okay, coming back to our UiPath, here it is. And then I will just open main. With that, right, as we already have our application, what I will do is I will just go to this particular option available right here, which says data scraping. If I just click on that, just a minute. I'm a bit new to Teams, so apologies on that if something goes wrong. So yeah. Here I am, okay. So as soon as I have clicked on that data scraping, the small wizard will pop out here. If I just click on next, see, there is something that you can see on the screen. Okay, there is a cursor that we can see, and here, anything that I choose to click on, if I just click on one, it's asking for something, okay, which you selected a table cell. Would you like to extract the data from the whole table? So that is what we actually want. So I will just click yes. If you see, it was able to fetch all the information from this. Okay. And so it was able to fetch only the information till this 10 number. If I just go here, you can see it was only 10. Okay, 10 Kangana. But there are different pages available here, as you can see. What if I want to get those data also into my extracted thing? I have to just click finish, and then here it will itself ask you if there are multiple pages available right here. With that, what I will do is I will just click on yes, there are many fields available, many pages, and then I will click on next. Okay, so as you can see, it was able to generate a workflow. Okay, nothing you did here. You have done just some clicks, and by that, UiPath was capable of getting all these things done for you. And there are some inputs that goes right here. Okay, if you're not familiar with UiPath, I will just try to guide you through this. Okay, when I just did all the process in the UI, right? In the backend, UiPath was collecting a lot of other information. It was collecting which type of browser I was using. Because it was IE, it is IE here, and then selector. Okay, whenever you're trying to interact with an web application or website or something of that kind, or it can be even Windows applications, there are some attributes, okay, there are some parameters and elements with which it was actually built. The selector is what we call the attributes, okay? It has to know, because if I as a human know this is inventory management system, but the system doesn't understand it, right? It has to get some name. It has to get, okay, this particular thing represents this on screen. Okay, and this doesn't represent this notepad. Okay, just to differentiate different applications, it will take some inputs. And this is what it is. And the timeout here is something if a bot is unable to find that particular table that we have just scraped, okay, it will wait for this time span, and then it will just throw an error saying this screen was not there. That was about this attached browser that was automatically generated. Moving ahead, This is another activity that was used by UiPath to fetch the structured data. Here, if I see, right, there are inputs like extract this. This is something again. This is something, some metadata that UiPath was able to fetch from the website. Work on that. Okay, and again, here also we have the selector. It says, hope you are able to see the screen right here. I'm unable to zoom it. So there is web control tab called table. Okay, from where this UiPath, next time whenever we run it, we'll try to get the information from that. And then a max number of results it will try to get is 100. If you want it to be 1,000 or something else, you can just change it. Okay. And the next selector, because you have selected a spanning, right? There was many multiple pages. For that, this is the selector. With this, whatever UiPath will be able to fetch after this, it will give out to this data table. Okay, this is an output that we get from this extraction. Okay, so data table, if you are someone who is not from computer science background or somewhere, you might not understand what is data table. If I just see Excel, right, if there is an Excel sheet that we have. Suppose this is an Excel sheet. Okay, this is how the databases also will be, where every information that we have, right, every information that we have, would be easier to filter or to retrieve or to read if they are in a structured format. If I say name and if I say location, okay, and there is some information right here. Suppose one, okay, and then there is B and he stays in 2. And there is C and there is 3. Any information which is structured will be easier for us to query. With that in mind, right, this is something available which we can see, which we can save, or I can save it somewhere and then I can send it in the mail. But when it comes to this, right, it is generating a virtual database, a virtual data table that we can see. As we can see this thing, we can zip it, we can send it somewhere. The output generated by this can't be sent somewhere, but it can be consumed. Okay, so here responsibility stays with you, with what you will be actually able to do with this particular data table that is generated. So this stays only in the memory, okay, which is in the RAM, which will go away after this particular run. So you have to decide what you have to do with this. So for now, what I will do is, as we know, this thing will give us that particular output. I will try to display it some on the screen. Okay, let's see how it will be displayed on the screen, this result. So in this case, we have our result in extracted data table. And then here, if I just go, I have to click on extracted data table. And then this output, right, UiPath is helping us to convert a data table into a string, which is a plain text. But again, the input is data table type. If I just click over here, right, you will find the type of this is data table. And output should be string. In that case, what I will do is I will create another variable called result. And this type of this will be string. And I will just save it, control yes. Okay, if I just minimize it and go right here and click on result, here we can see that variable. And I will just click on this. So it's available to us. If in case, if I just try to run this time, if I just run it, okay. Here is this site. Okay, see, robot itself is going from page to page, and in the background, it is trying to fetch the data. In some time, we should be getting the information on the screen. It will take 30 seconds right here, because after third page, it was unable to find. This is a result because what we did is, right here, right? We have kept time of 30 seconds right here. The default is 30 seconds. After 30, we'll be getting those results on the screen. Okay, I think it has executed. Sorry, we have converted it, but we didn't display it on the screen. So what I will do is I will display the result on the screen. go back to this page and I will get it to the first page and then try to run this. As you can see, right, it's moving from first to third. And what I can say is, meanwhile, when it is trying to fetch the information, so what do you think the UiPath is exactly doing behind the scenes? Okay, what exactly is happening here? Okay, for someone who is trying to get into core development, they have to investigate further and understand what's happening behind the scenes. Okay, if you're someone who is not interested much into programming, but you want to get the work done, then this is for you. Okay, even say, as you can see, it was able to fetch all the 24 names available right here as data. Okay, this is the data the bot was able to do, was able to fetch. Okay, yeah, as I told, right, for someone who is trying to understand what goes behind it, what I can say is, UiPath or any other extraction tools will use some of the techniques internally, like HTML parsing, DOM parsing, and XPath, etc., to understand the content structure and get details about the node elements based on our selection. Okay, more to it, it will also use text pattern matching techniques sometimes. Okay, as we were able to get this and we know how to extract the data, let's take an Excel activity right now. I will take right range here. I've already told, right, whatever information we have, we can write it down to any another path that we have. Okay, as our dependencies had Excel, if we just remember, okay, we have Excel activities also. In this case, I will just drag this. Okay, that's the advantage of this data scraping tools or RPA, where there's not much efforts that you have to put in. The only efforts that you will have to understand here is how to design a particular process and get the work done, and how to use the available tools. And most importantly, how you should be good at logics. Okay, and then I will just create a file called result. And then in this, I will just pass our data table, which is extract data table. Okay, with this, what I expect to do is, if I just go to this, there is no Excel available right here, right? But let's run this once. Just go back to this and try to execute the program. Yeah, meanwhile, guys, if you have any queries or if you are good with whatever I have just explained, you can just type good to go further. Okay, so that I can move ahead with the use case too. As you can see, we have received this input as earlier. But this time, as you can see, there is another file that was created. And if I just click on this, there is data into it. Okay, this is the data that we have just scraped from the website. Okay, so this is how easy it is to get your work done by using this RPA. And another reason, if I just tell you, right, what's the use of RPA? Because this was something that I can do with something else also, just a simple data extraction tool. But in this case, if my this particular site was already launched, okay, if this was closed, if I run this, it will fail because it can't find that element. Okay, this will try to search for this element, which indeed is not available. Okay, in this case, what I can do is, I can use another activity which is available in RPA. Here, see the different inputs that it will be asking you for. It will be asking which browser type you're using, which is IE. I want to launch IE. And then it is expecting the URL. Okay, I have to just give down my URL here. And here, okay, this URL should be a string. So in this case, I will just add double quotes at the start and at the end. Once this is done, if I run this time, right, it should actually launch the browser first, as we can see, and then it will start the scraping process. Okay, similar to that, right? If you're using just a data scraping tool, it will just help you to extract the things. But when you use it with RPA and you try to achieve this with RPA, there are different things that you'll be having advantage on. One thing is you can launch the site and then you can scrape it. And then the other thing is you can achieve the other things. Like you can retry, okay? If the website was not launched, there are different mechanisms available ready with us that can be used. If I just click on retry, right, here is a retry and retry scope. If for the first time when you're trying to launch this particular website, it fails, it can retry it. Okay, it can retry it. If I just see number of retries that you have to do it, you can do it 3 times retry and at what intervals. We can also tell what that retry after every 1 minute or 2 minutes. Okay, so that is what we can do with RPA. So this was about a simple use case that I thought to show you, okay, by showing the capabilities of RPA to you, where we were able to launch a website and then scrape this particular data available to us. Okay, this is...
How to scrape audio data? Is it possible?
Sorry?
Audio from video. Is it possible to scrap it?
No. Actually, that we have to do. Whoever has asked that, we can't achieve that by using RPA for now. It is only for the UI thing. When it comes to that, right, codecs, we have to use that framing and everything, and that can be done by UiPath. That can be done by .NET and other programming languages because it's a complex process. Converting that into subtitles or converting into some other things. Okay. Even for that, we have some libraries. Okay. Some are paid and some are free to convert. Because whatever is possible with .NET is possible with RPA. The only difference between programming and RPA is here you already have some components built. Okay. Where in .NET, okay, if you're trying to convert some audio into text, right, in that case, you have the program already written. But anyway, if you want to use that, you have to again understand that code and then use it. But with RPA, someone, right, if I just go back to this, someone who is good at RPA, sorry, at programming, has created all these activities. Okay, I also have some activities in this particular thing. If I just go back to manage packages, and these are a few things that are created by other people, okay, who have thought that this component will be useful to someone. Similar to that, as you have asked, there are some activities that can be used to achieve that particular scenario that you told, where we'll be converting audio to text. Okay, that is possible. So I think that's clear for you all. Maybe we can move ahead with the another use case. Yeah, fine. Just I will try to move ahead with the other use case that we have. This is another use case that we have with us, which is e-commerce. Okay. The next thing that we'll be looking at it is use case, which is depending on the e-commerce data scraping. Okay, here when we go ahead with the e-commerce, there are a lot of complexities that comes in. If I open Amazon, this is how Amazon looks like. And see, there is this structure looks a little complex. Okay, for the first four tables, there are no four tables. There are only three cards available here, and then there are four and kind of things. Okay, in this case, what we can do is we can even automate Amazon in this case. For this, just to save the time, okay, what I did is I have already implemented a small workflow for that. I will just try to take you through workflow that I have already implemented. Okay, it's similar to what we have seen. If I just take you through the data scraping process, give me a second. Yeah, as you can see, right, here also we have made the use of open browser, which is taking a URL, which is this URL, okay? And then once that is done, I'm using an pre-existing activity called element exist. Element exist, if I just scroll down, right, there is an activity called element exist. The importance of this element exist is, suppose the bot, our RPA bot has just launched this site, and we don't know if it was successfully launched or there was, due to some internet problem, it was not actually open. Just to confirm that, what we are doing is we are taking this activity, and to this, okay, we are spying this particular logo, okay, that this, right? And not to confuse you, I've just dragged this here and then used this. Okay, in this case, I have gone to this site and I have spied this. Okay, if I just click on this, right, it will, if I just navigate to my web application, I'll be able to select the items from this. Anything that I want. Just to confirm that if it is successfully launched, I'm selecting this. If I click on this, it will be generated like this. As you can see, the selector here, which says I'm looking out for that Amazon.in logo, is similar to this, what we have already. Okay. With this, I'm just deleting this newly created one. So with this, this particular output will be saved to a Boolean. Okay. Boolean is something which will have only true or false values. So we know actually if this was successfully launched or not successfully launched. In this case, we are taking this particular output, which is successful launch, which is again a variable basically of Boolean type. I'm using that and I'm giving two message boxes. If this is true, it was able to recognize that, it will say browser opened successfully. If it was failed, then it will say failed to launch the browser. Okay. Again, because right now, suppose it was successful and we have the screen with us, with this particular elements right there. In this case, what I want to do is I want to give user some options, which are called input dialog box. Okay, this is an activity which we can use to get some inputs from the users. Okay, this is the activity that I have used, in which I'm just deleted that because we already have an input dialog box. Here, I'm just displaying something saying select one option to search. Okay, how this will look on the screen, I will just show you. With that, what will happen is there will be a pop-up that will appear once we launch the Amazon site. Once this is launched, we will get a pop-up in which we can enter. We can select options like mobile phones, own power banks, fridges, etc. Okay, we are actually giving options to the user by using this activity. And whatever he selects, right, that we will be saving in this particular variable called result. So finally, we have a result which will have either mobile phones, power banks, or fridges in it. Then we have another activity which is type into activity. Okay, this type into, which we have used here, is referring to this particular element on the screen. Nothing we have done here. As soon as I have dragged this, I have clicked on indicate on screen, and then by using Alt Tab, I have moved into the website that I want to automate. And then, as you can see the cursor, right, I have just placed it here. With that, I have got the selector for this. Okay, now bot has an understanding of what this, where actually it should enter the data. There I have passed the result. What is result? It is something that we have already selected. It can be mobiles, power banks, fridges, etc. With that, right, now what it will do is it will try to enter this mobiles or anything over there in this field. Once that is done, it will click on search. Okay, this also have spied. This is click activity. Okay, this is what you have to do. Nothing more than right here. Not much programming involved into it. But consider, okay, if you are a good programmer, you will have a lot of scope to excel here, because that's the advantage that RPA developer gets. Because I'm from web development background. Okay, as soon as I got into RPA, I had an advantage over others, where if I don't find some activity right here, I just create it. Okay, so that's an advantage of that. Even I intentionally don't remember some activities, because I can do it by using programming. Okay, so if you are a programmer, then it would be a play for you right here. Then it will click back to the code. It will just click on that search button by using this activity. It will search here. If I just assuming bot has entered mobiles here, and then the bot will click on search. And then we have a number of options coming over here, and we want to fetch all these things. Okay, for that, what I'm doing is, right here, what I did is I have used switch activity. Switch, for someone who is not into programming, switch is something which will give you an advantage of driving through different routes. Okay, it will allow you to, suppose I want to go to college, then I might have a different route. Okay, if I want to go to office, I will have a different route. Okay, such kind of things might happen. So for mobiles, okay, the reason why I have taken switch is, if I'm going to take this particular mobiles, right, for me, this is the view. Okay, they are vertical here, this particular results. But in this case, if I just click on power banks, okay, the results are horizontal. Okay, there is a little difference in the alignment. Okay, so this will cause your robot to fail. So we, as an RPA developer, as a business person, are responsible to handle all these errors and all these things. So we have different structure for different results. When it is mobile, we are doing it like this. And when it is power bank, we have another extracted table. It's similar, okay? Don't be confused about how it was done. It's the same, okay? Here also we have used this. I'm just navigating through this, and then I'll click on here. And if I click right here, right, it will show me this. And then I have to show another one. See, last time when we did, the robot didn't ask me for the second element, okay? Because the structure there was too simple. Okay, so the robot's intelligence was enough for it to recognize the pattern. But here we are showing it the path. Okay, I have shown the robot that this is the first, this is the second. With that conclusion, it was able to find the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. I just click on next. See, it was able to find all these elements available here. Got it, right? So that's how it was able to fetch the inputs. So this is how we were able to fetch all these things in this particular page. Here also, we can take the advantage and see, it's this particular site is, we will have around more than 100 if I just scroll on. So I'm not going to click on next to get all the inputs, just to keep it simple. So this is what I have done right here. Okay. Here in every switch activity, we have this extracted data, which will do that work for us. Once that is done, we are just trying to know the count of it, and then we are closing the tab. And finally, what's the use of data if we are not saving it somewhere? Last time, as I have saved it into an Excel file, just to add some variation to it, I'm writing it back to a .csv file. Okay, with see, here the name is not hard-coded, okay, as we have done last time. It was result.xlsx. Okay, but here it's result plus this. Result, if you remember, Result is nothing but the value that we have actually selected. Result can be mobile names, our power banks, or fridges. Okay, based on the input that we give, it will end up saving the result right there. To see this working, what I will do is I will just close this and I will run it. See, the bot was able to launch this site, and as we have already given the instructions to display some values over there, it was able to open the browser. And then, okay, this is something that I was talking about. We ourselves are giving, so you might tell, okay, there might be some other option that the user might be trying to buy. It can be laptop or something. For the simplicity, I have used this particular options. Okay, but if it's in real time, we will give it a free text. Okay, you are allowed to enter whatever you want, so that you are not restricted to this particular items right here. Okay. For the first time, I will select mobiles and I will click on OK. I'm not doing anything. Okay, the bot is trying to enter the data right there and has clicked on mobiles. And it is showing me the message saying it has found 16 results. If I scroll down and if we just count all these things available in the vertical thing, then there must be 16 items. Okay, all those things it was able to find. And then again, okay, it's RPA. Okay, being an RPA developer, it's not easy for you to fetch everything. It will be only capable to fetch these elements because all these things right here are following some pattern, but these are not into our pattern. So there should be another extract data structure that we have to use, similar to what we have done right now, to fetch these elements that are available right here. Okay, just to keep it simple, as we have got 16 results, I'm just clicking on OK, and it has ended. Okay, so if in case we just want to check out what were the results of this, I'm going to this, and I'll just refresh it, and I see mobile CSV. Okay, just to make it simple, I'll go here. So this file was generated right away at 3:24 p.m. If I just open this, so it has all the names of mobile phones. Okay, there are mobile phones that we have got. And in this case, what I will do is I will run it again. Okay, it was opened it. This time I will try to search the power banks. So bot is able to enter the data, search for that, and it is trying to fetch the power bank details. So this time it was able to find 47 results. If we end up counting all this, it will result to 49 on the first page. And then if I just click on this, it has closed the tab, as we have closed tab here. And with our expectations, there should be another file that must have been generated. Not this folder, sorry. Yeah, power bank. Okay, it was generated at 3:25. If I just open this here, we have actually extracted different fields also, not as last time. Okay, so that's what. Okay, every page, right, based on their complexity, they will give out different values to us. If you're not getting everything in one shot, you have to use different data structures or customize your particular. When I say you have to customize, I'm talking about this. Okay, here, while fetching this, if you're unable to fetch every information at a single shot, you have to make use of 2 to 3 data structures and get name, prices, and everything. Because the data structure of power banks was so simple, the bot was able to fetch the name, its cost in rupees, and then the rating of it. Okay, all this information it was able to fetch. So this was about another use case that I thought of showing it to you. So anyone who have any queries can just ask me so that I can clarify and we can move on to the next thing that we are about to.
So that data that we enter in the password text field can be fetched?
Okay, you want to say that you want to save password also, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, in this case, right? So what happens is, because we are having this, as I have launched that, and if we want to log in and buy something, in that case, because our passwords are sensitive, okay, in Windows, okay, if we can search for that, we have something called Manage Windows Credentials. Okay, it is a place somewhere you can save out your credentials. Okay, in this case, I already have some existing credentials. I can go click right here, add generic credentials, and type Amazon, and then I can say sharadraju@gmail.com, and then my password is something. Okay, and then I can save it. So with this, our password is protected. Okay, no one can actually see this password. Okay, though there are some ways to fetch this, and it is not secured. Okay, because there are some hacking things that we can do and fetch this. But this is something the bot can use. Okay, our bot, what it will do is, if I just go here, if I go to activities and search, okay, so here are the activities that can be used to fetch those credentials and then enter those into the websites or web applications that we are trying to automate. So this is how the bot will be capable of getting those things. Yeah, so that was about the use case. And any other questions, I will just wait for 1 minute. Maybe if you have any queries, guys, you can just ask me. Okay, fine. With that, right, it's similar to what we called, similar to, as I have shown you, Amazon.com, we have different applications. Okay, there is a site called taste.com.au. Here also, okay, this I'm not going to do automated, but it is something that I want to leave for you guys. Okay, after this session, maybe to apply or test out how efficient it is, you can try to go down to this and just click on recipes somewhere. And these are also available as a structured data, right? If you just go through that, you can try to fetch all this. Okay, try to fetch data from a single page. And if you are able to achieve that, then try to go for 4 pages or 72 pages also. And check how fast you will be able to get this information. Okay, and that was about this. And if I just want to move ahead with the other things. And as we have just seen how we can achieve this by using RPA, okay, the next thing that comes to our mind, okay, because just learning how to scrape the data will not help us anyway. Okay, but learning where can we actually use it will definitely help us. Okay, and make a difference for sure. With that consideration, right? So for us, it's important to look at some real-time use cases where we can put ourselves of our own, just gain knowledge. I have shown, right? As I have shown, you can just try it out with taste.com. Okay, after the session to test your knowledge. And the data that we have just fetched, okay, will be used for research, monitoring, and comparison and analysis purposes. Okay, so some of the leading consumers of web or data scraping are industries like, as you can see, e-commerce, recruitment, real estate, and travel. Okay, these are a few companies that actually take very good advantage of data scraping technologies. Okay, because they mostly depend on that. If I just take you through the e-commerce example, right? All their marketing strategies, okay, of how the product offering should be and how the sales campaign should be run and how the customer services are tailored according to data available to them. Though data scraping, through data scraping, they can try to analyze the data like product details, prices, reviews, and many such outcomes. And if you are interested in machine learning and big data, right? So that's where this will be useful. Because what happens is all these websites, suppose in some case, maybe a user comes to your site, you are an e-commerce owner, someone comes to buy your particular product, but what happens is he comes to your product, he looks at it, and then what happens is he just goes to your cart also, and when he was about to enter his credit card details, he has left the site. Okay, and you are mad at the strategies. Okay, you don't know what has just happened. To understand that, you can use data scraping, okay, combined with machine learning to predict, okay, what are your chances of sales, or what exact point where you losing your business. Okay, so this is where you will exactly find the usage of this particular thing in e-commerce. Okay, and this remains same with other industries also, as we have discussed. So it remains same with recruitment, travel, real estate, and research. And basically, it can also be used in social media websites, okay, to analyze the trends. Because right these days, okay, most of the advertisements and most of the marketing strategies are targeted on the hashtags that we use. Okay, so it's very important for the companies to recognize which hashtag is trending right now so that they can get some attention from the industries, from the customers, and try selling something to them, right? So in this case also, web scraping can help them, because by using web scraping, you can go ahead with your Twitter account or Facebook or YouTube, or you can consider LinkedIn. Okay, you can just go over there and just try to run the script or run your particular robot. It will run continuously for around 12 hours, 24 hours, and it will gather as much information as possible so that you can work on that. Okay, through which you will be getting more insights into it. And to give more industry use cases, you can consider email marketing campaigns. Okay, in email marketing campaigns, what happens is you have to send emails to different people. Okay, that's how companies generate leads. Okay, in this case also, it's the same with that. In this case, what you have to do is maybe consider a YouTube video is there. Okay, and in that video, you find some comments, and there are different mail IDs that were there who are actually expecting a service, okay, but they're not finding it. And you are a company who is trying to sell that product, which will be useful for those customers. So now what you will do is, you by using the RPA or any web scraping tools, you will try to go to that particular platform, YouTube or Amazon or something. You will scrape all the data from that, and then by using text patterns, you will find the email IDs of them. Okay, and suppose, okay, if it's easy for you to do it manually, if there are 10, 20, or 30 emails, but consider if there are 1,000, 5,000, 10,000 emails on the screen. Okay, and we don't want to waste our time, right, doing something which a bot can do, which can replace us and which can be more efficient than us. We might fall asleep, okay, but it will do 24/7, 365 days a day. So that's how, that's where we will find some things on that also. So yeah, this were few different industry use cases that we can think of. Though, another thing, real time use case that I want to share is, most of the companies, right, are built on coupons. Okay, they don't do anything. They just give you coupons. Okay, there are few sites that are generating some revenue by selling coupons, where they just scrape all the websites. If they are into travel domain, they just go to all the sites, because they can't do it with APIs, right? Those companies don't allow them to access. They don't allow the access to those sites. So only option left is scraping. So that's where they just go to many travel sites available, and then they will get all the data, and then they will display all these things in their sites. And that's how they are actually helping us, right? Whenever we want some coupons, we just go to them rather than going to every site and then fetching information. So in this case, because they are adding value to our life, we are able to pay them. Okay, that's how they are also generating. And finally, because we are totally into data scraping, we might have thoughts of scraping everything. Even lawyers scrape some data because they want to understand what has happened for the decade or two decades. And they take some analysis on that and then they try to make the judgments on this. And finally, as data scraping can be illegal, okay, sometimes because it's some type of illegal activity where you're trying to rob off someone else's data. Okay, because that's something that that is giving them credits and that is something which is unique to them. But what we are trying to do is we are trying to fetch out their data. And in this case, we should be definitely very cautious while performing such acts and also admit to whatever that particular website allows us to do and whatever their rules are, we have to do them. And most importantly, rather than the act of scraping itself, the usage of collected data may be of more concern. Okay, so that's where we have to be more cautious about it. Yeah, I think that was about the data scraping things. And if I just go back to the UiPath tool, right, to extract. So data extracting is just a part of every industry that exists today, because most, according to the research, right, mostly around every company that is in media, travel, or e-commerce, they are using technology, data scraping technology, to almost like 40%. Okay, but just scraping wouldn't help us. Okay, if scraping is only the thing that we are trying to do, we can use other tools also. And most of them doesn't even require you to pay. But in this case, the main agenda of using RPA right here is because we want to build something robust. Okay. If I'm running something today, it should be running, it should be capable of executing for the next 365 days. Okay, yeah, with a condition that the site should not change. Okay, whatever site we are trying to automate, right, there should not be any major changes until and unless that it would be able to do good work with it. Okay, and the reason why we have chosen RPA for this data scraping is because, see, this is the, if you just go with another tools, right, there we will just have this feature available with us. But as RPA technology provides us with different options, okay, it allows us to launch a website and then write that data to somewhere else. And we can also retry it sometime and we can allow it to run for 24/7. Okay, even if there is a loss in connection, we can achieve that. If you want to add other features to it, if you want this folder to be sent to someone else after you do everything, okay, in this case, you can take the help of mail activities. Okay, you can just send your file, whatever was generated, through email. Okay, this is an opportunity that is there with us. Okay, that comes with RPA. Because with other things, right, if you're trying to do with programming, okay, if you yourself are a programmer and you try to achieve with you, and then you have to write some extra components to send an email. Okay, here you can just give out your to me, what would be the subject, and you can just attach your attachments. And what if you just want to copy it to some other folder? Okay, you can just do it by using copy file act. That's how easy it becomes when you start to use RPA and data scraping, right? And most of the businesses, because I'm already working as an RPA developer, for the first 1.5 years, I was a web developer, and then I have just shifted to RPA. Since that, I'm working, and most of the companies these days, right, most of the companies are like adopting RPA, which is going to grow for another 4 to 5 years, and then maybe it might saturate. So there are different job opportunities available for the freshers. Okay, because if they are constant, because RPA being a new technology, right, the problem with that is less resources. And when there are less resources, they have to pay more. Okay, when they pay more, the profits that the companies will gain are very too low, too slim, I can say. Okay, with that, what they will try to do is they will try to hire a lot of freshers. Okay, because there will be a cutoff of around 50%, okay, when they hire freshers. In this case, what you can do is you can start preparing. I would suggest this is for someone, I will not suggest RPA for someone who is trying to get, completely into what you say, core development, but I will suggest someone this to someone who is trying to get into RPA, but get into something which will be involving a less programming knowledge. And then because some people, right, even we start off with the computer science thing, we might be more interested in analytics. Okay, we might be more interested in how businesses work. Okay, and we might be interested in gaining some profits to business. In this case, do consider taking up the path of RPA with the opportunities out there. And if you want to practice, because my contact number is there with Shankar sir, so maybe you can just try to contact me in case if you are interested, so that I can just show you the path through which you can start automating your college works also. Because there are, I can say, in attending some college sessions, and then we have also conducted few hackathons, okay, in few colleges, okay, Savita and other things, Zapier colleges, and they were actually doing good work with RPA. They have automated a lot of things that the teachers actually have to do called assignments, and they have also automated bell ring, okay, and certificate generation and everything. So if you can just try out RPA, right, there are different, if you just approach your administration maybe and you ask out for some knowledge of what's happening inside office, okay, college office, you will find use cases, okay, because there are, I can personally say there are, there will be some processes that your college staff is spending time on, which are, which actually doesn't need their attention over there, okay, because maybe they can start spending some quality time with students on some other productive things, like what you say, whenever there is an event, you can start, someone has to type those names and everything, right? That can be automated. And your whenever someone doesn't attend or doesn't come to college kind of things, and all these things can be automated. Yeah, so this was, there's were some industry use cases and the opportunities that you have with the RPA. Yeah, guys, I'm done with the, done from my side, because we still have time. You can throw out your questions that you have regarding data scraping regarding RPA in this case.
Participants, kindly unmute your mic and ask the questions, because chat box is not available for our guest. Thank you.
Yes, you can ask anything about RPA, okay? Because it's a platform that I can say that the community is providing for you. Okay, it's a great opportunity for you, because this is something that not everyone will get. Okay, where you're getting a chance to interact with some people. Okay, maybe in the morning also you might have joined the session of Sudhir Nimagada. Okay, he's also experienced. He also have 10 years of experience. Because we work in real time, right? You can ask different questions. It doesn't have to be with this topics only. If you want to get something, some other topics also, if I'm capable of telling that, I will just guide you through that. Okay, because, yes.
Scrapping the CAPTCHA is not a security issue, is it?
No. Yeah, Shankar, so basically the problem is with CAPTCHA, right? Though RPA tools and the other OCR engines that are available, okay, the Abby Flexi and Kepao and many other things, which are already well-established companies in the field of OCR, they are trying to handle it, but to some extent they are able to do. But these days, the CAPTCHA is changing, right? With where we have to conform about the puzzles that are coming up. Okay, they are trying to handle them, but still they are unable to do. Again, when it comes to CAPTCHA, right, it will go to unethical side of this thing, because CAPTCHA itself is there for the human thing. And though companies encourage that, but still there is no good solution available in the market still now for that CAPTCHA. A lot of companies are still fighting for that particular thing.
Okay, and how to protect my data from scrapping?
And that is completely that we can't do from this side, but we have a few copyrights being provided by other companies. Okay, and we can, that's the only way actually. We have to just place copyright so that you can file something against someone who is trying to use your data. Because recently it has happened with our site also, Excel Cult, okay, because someone was trying to make a book out of whatever content that we had, but I was unable to do something apart from just creating something around that. So yeah, data anyway is not secured over internet, as we already know. But still, we can have some copyright companies. There are copyright companies which will just provide a few rights which we can put out over there, so that in case if we need, we can just file a complaint against them. That's all. I think there's no much security to the content we create.
Okay. And UiPath, is it offers any visualization for data?
Visualization when it comes to UiPath, right, because it's completely into this, it allows us to integrate UiPath with third-party apps like Kibana, OKR, Tableau. You can, because whenever we run a robot, see, UiPath actually have some products called UiPath Studio. UiPath Studio is somewhere we actually implement the things. Okay, as I have shown my screen, right, this is UiPath Studio, where we will actually implement the code. And then we have robot. Okay, we have robot. This is something, this they have just taken out, the UiPath robot, for the community recently. So that robot will help you run the code what we have developed. And the other thing is orchestrator. Orchestrator, what it will do is, it will help us to monitor. See, as a person, I was just able to run one bot. Suppose in case I am a company and I want to replace 1,000 people in my company, then I have to anyway develop 1,000 robots. But as a single person, I can't keep logging into system and checking into it, right? So for that, orchestrator will help us control 10,000 robots at a single click. Okay, it will tell us which robot is currently working and which robot is not currently working. Just to give an overview of that. In that case, it will generate a few logs in the backend saying this particular Amazon extraction was successful 20 times in a day, and it has failed 10 times in a day. And the reason was this. When it generates such kind of things, right, when it comes to, if it's a one bot, then we will just get one log. But if it's the case of 10,000 robots running the whole day, it will generate a huge amount of data, right? For that, orchestrator actually have a dashboard, okay, which can be used basically to display this particular visualizations. But if we want to extend it, because companies doesn't want to use something new that UiPath has provided, they always prefer to use their kind of already being used technology, such as Kibana. Kibana is also a visualization tool that you can use. And then there is Tableau, right? You can use Tableau for that. And you can also create dashboards with whatever data that is being created by the robots. As if I just go down to this, and if I go to this, right? If I just click Control L here, these are few logs that the robot has generated. Okay, I'm running a code since morning, right? So this is something that code the robot has actually generated. If I open this, see, this is something that robot has generated. It's telling that at 11:06, okay, this process has execution has started, and at what time it has done this, and at what machine, in what machine it was running, and what was the process name, and what was the robot name. Okay, robot name is nothing but my name, basically, whatever user that I have right now. And again, it has started attached browser, Amazon page. It can't find the UI element. Similar to this, it will start logging it. As you can see, it's just a one run and we have this much data. Yeah, for that, as you have told, right, to visualize the data, we have to use, most of the companies use third party, but you can also use RPA, UiPath's native thing. Okay, we will have a UiPath cloud platform for that, basically. So this is what we can use for this purpose.
Okay, and using this software robot, whatever the data that I have on my screen only scrapped, or the data that I stored in my memory also can be retrieved.
Memory in the sense?
Memory in the sense the database, but not a displayed on the screen.
Okay, yeah, that also we can do. So because right now we were dealing with UI part of the automation, it was there. If we want to fetch something in our database, right, we can use SQL database right now. So these are few activities that come default with this, but in case, as you have told, right, you have to fetch some information from database, we have to use database activities.
Database or flat files.
Yeah, exactly. So if we want to get something from database, we can use this activities. Okay, as soon as, just a minute. As soon as I install it, right, if I go right here and click on database, these activities are available to me. I can connect to database, I can disconnect, I can fetch, I can insert and everything. And if you want to read something from Excel sheet, and then say, suppose a use case of this could be, you have an Excel sheet which contains student details for whom you have to create a certificate. In this case, you can just use this read range available here. It will try to read your particular Excel from whatever sheet that you mention, and you will have the output in a virtual data table. Okay, which then you can use to create all those things that you were asking about. So again, here, if you have something, some template in your Word file, okay, then we can go ahead and just use Word activities. It's not just kind of things. Okay, these are Word activities that were created by UiPath. There are maybe we might be using Oracle database. In this case, maybe UiPath doesn't have activities for that. Someone, right, who is interested and who knows programming well, they end up creating some on that. If I just click on Word, right, let's see, there are different things. Maybe I have a Word file in which I want to add photo. I can add it. If I want to read the text in Word file, that also I can do. If I want to save it as PDF, because Word, whenever we have certificates being prepared, right, we will have it in Word file and then we will create it to PDF. In this case, this will be a good match for us. Yeah. So that way, any input, right, which is in digital form, if it's a PDF, we can read PDF. If it's a scanned thing also, we can do that also. Okay. Those are a few.
Can also be scrapped. Say, for example, I'm sending data from one machine to another machine that is in travel. Okay. That time, is it can be captured?
No. Actually, it should be available at somewhere. Okay. If we are getting it from emails, maybe I'm sending out a Excel file to you, or I'm sending out a file, a PDF file to you. As soon as it arrives into my source, okay, where the bot is fetched from, then only it can start the work.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thanks.
Participants, any questions? Okay. Kirtana ma'am?
Yes, sir. Shall we end the meeting, sir?
Yes. Time to wind up.
Yes. Sir, thank you. Thank you very much for sharing your knowledge with us on data scrapping, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.